like a siesta that you get in Spain, which is really cool in summer months. And in winter, it's a bit shorter. And then we come back to school in the afternoon, do normal lessons, and then we finish school at about 5:30, depending on different schools we go to. And then we have a dinner break. And in senior years, well, younger years, from 7 to 10, we just go home. And then in senior years, year 11, year 12, including year 10, we have to come back to school after dinner to do supervised self-study sessions until 8 or 9 o'clock. And that's our normal school days. And in year 11, year 12, because we have to prepare for this really, really intense college entrance exam. It's a nationwide exam, so you're competing with everyone in the entire country. And we had to study, our normal school days go from Mondays to Saturdays. Saturdays is a normal school day. And then on Sundays, it's funny enough, at the end of each month, the last Sunday basically, we get to have the whole Sunday off. And then every other Sundays, we can only sleep in the mornings, and we'll have to come back to school after lunch. On Sunday afternoons, supervised study times. So that was one of the biggest differences. And also another thing I noticed, in our school, we're really lucky. In each classrooms, we have maximum 20, 25 students. In my school, my class, we had, my year group, we had a whole about 24 different classes. Each class ranges from between 40 was the minimum number of students in each class. My class, because I was in the top group and a lot of people in that class, we had about 65 students in a single classroom. So the classroom was literally a single gap between the desks that you had to squeeze in to get to your seat. So yeah, it was really, really high pressure. How different from schooling experience that.
So your year group had 20, 24 classes, each with average 50 kids in. Okay, that's a big group. And tell us about some of those interesting things that I hear, where in the morning you had to do lots of movements and movements, the high exercise.
Yeah.
Tell us about some of those interesting things.
Yeah, as you probably know, there's a lot of, as Asians, a lot of people wearing glasses. And one of the things that we had to do during recess, before you go to recess, we had to sit down as a whole school and play this music through this loudspeakers, and everyone had to do this sort of eye exercise. Do like pretty much like acupunctural exercises around your eye. We have to do that for 2 minutes. You have to do four different sort of movements around your face so you can relax your eyes. And then once a week, early in the morning, we do this morning, I can't even describe it. It's sort of like a body movement. It's like coordinated exercise, basically. The whole school, everyone get onto the school grounds and line up and perfectly, you know, squares each class, and we'll do this amazing thing, something like that, and whatever, and I can't remember the name of this. But yeah, it was really, really cool. And then we also do military training. So at the beginning of each semester, so half, we do it twice a year, the beginning of the school time, the first week, basically, every day, we don't have any classes, we literally get military soldiers to come to school and train us to do marching and all the standing the sun, no movements, you can't even, you know, blink your eyes for a minute or something like that. It's all about coordination and discipline training. It was fun times.
Wow, very different, very different. So, Stan, one interesting thing is obviously you have a great passion for the natural world and nature. How did this begin? Do you remember how you first got interested in studying nature?
Like I said, I was born in this part of China that was back then surrounded by nature. There was barely any sort of urbanization. The houses were made of straw and mud. And the Tibetan plateau, so behind the house, there were just basically Tibetan mountain ranges running through and creeks running behind. My grandpa used to take me out to the creek. We used to catch all these tadpoles and little fish and bring them home and try to raise them, and then a couple of them end up dying. And then he would show me all these places where the birds would nest, magpies and sparrows and things like that. I still remember one of those really, really beautiful memories. I rescued a little sparrow. So the houses in that Tibetan plateau, the windows in particular, it's a double layer. So sometimes the birds can get trapped between those double layer glasses. And there was one day one of the neighbors called me and said, oh, we found a sparrow in the window, it's trapped in there. So I went over there, I tried to manage and rescue the sparrow, I took it out and hold it in my hands. And that was the moment I was like, oh my God, this is absolutely amazing. The feather, the texture, and you can feel the heartbeat it's trying to fly out of my hand. And eventually I let it go. So that was the moment that still just, you know, really imprinted in my mind. And that kind of probably made me fall in love so much with nature and wildlife. And ever since I was a kid, and I always wanted to come to Australia, because, you know, I'm watching one of David Attenborough's documentary about koalas and platypus and kangaroos, and I just like, oh my God, this country has some really, really, really weird animals, and I really, really wanted to come here and study them. And,
yeah. So how did you do it? How did you get here?
Well, I studied really hard because obviously when I was a kid I didn't speak English and I had to learn English and at school, and tried really hard to practice my English and got it really, really well at university. And then there was a student exchange program. I was very lucky, it was full paid, like full scholarship exchange program with Bond University in Gold Coast. That was back in 2008. So I came to Australia for the first time. During student exchange, I basically took myself to this wildlife park and I said, okay, can I volunteer for you guys? Because I really want to learn about the animals here, because being an exchange student, academic wasn't a high priority, so I wanted to experience some of these animals. So I spent 2 months there volunteering, learning all about Australian animals from this amazing person working at the zoo, Terry, I still remember his name, so taught me all about Australian animals. And then I said, you know what, I'm going to come back. I really, really want to come back to study for that. So I went back to China, finished my degree, and applied for my master's at James Cook University. As recommended to me by one of the colleagues at the zoo, the saying James Cook University in Townsville was amazing because it was right in the tropics, and study all those amazing animals, and applied and got in. And
there you go. And just briefly, you went on to do a PhD on...
Yeah.
Birds in Queensland?
Yeah.
Brief moment on that one?
Yeah, sure. So I had an opportunity to work with this endangered bird called black-throated finch, which is a bird that only lives in central Queensland. I discovered the largest population of that bird in the centre of this giant mining company, Adani. Some of you guys might have heard of it. So I let that information out. So I was trying to work out the genetic side of things, because some of you guys might know, as we go to a small population, people really closely related tend to inbreed with each other, so there might be some genetic consequences to that. And I was trying to find out if it is the same thing with that small pocket of birds that in small numbers are also very isolated. So that was basically the premises of my research back then.
Right. Stanley, why don't we here? Of course, you've found lots of very interesting birds here, and I feel a little bit guilty always when I walk around, and then you tell me all these amazing birds that we had no idea are here. So, do you want to share with us just some of the things you've found in the bird life here on our campus?
Yeah, so I've been keeping a list of birds at Glenaeon, also just in the bush, at the bird, we always get lists. So, the Glenaeon list so far is getting close to 100 different species of birds, just I can see around the school ground as long as all the way down to the creek. A lot of really, really cool, colourful little birds that live in the bush. Two particular ones, some of you guys might have seen them. It's one of the superb fairy wrens, the blue and black, that go down to the creek. And then you go to the round oval side of the bush and you get another type of fairy wren, which is even more colourful. It's called the variegated fairy wren. You've got blue, red, and black, and neon greens. Absolutely amazing. So I've been also, at the same time, not just observing them, I've been tagging them as well. Some of you guys probably have noticed some of the brush turkeys walking around school have really nice shiny jewelries on their legs. So I've been tagging most of the birds, including brush turkeys and kookaburras and all the tiny little birds in the bush as well, so that I can actually track what sort of birds coming through this area. And if you capture them again, so I can actually see if there's any changes in the feather, whether they're breeding, all this kind of information that you can't really get from just looking at them. So, yeah.
Wow, and this is an ongoing project?
Yes, it is an ongoing project.
Any chance for students to be involved in it?
Absolutely. I've got quite a lot of students done that with me, and some of the Year 12 students, so do doing their science extension project on that bird with me, and now year 10 students have done a bird banding session with me in term 4 last year, so quite a few of them have already seen that process. So I'm obviously interested to take a